I hope you guys have gone through the previous lecture, right? Because it will become important for you to understand the previous lecture and then you can follow this much more easily. All right, so I'll just go through this problem. Right, I'll just go through the first case one of this problem very quickly, just like a recap, and then we'll move on to case two, right, which is what we are supposed to do now. Okay. So the problem that we are trying to solve here, that is, some particles are coming in from the left with a certain energy and then they encounter a barrier. The barrier is at the position x equal to 0. Can all of you hear me and see the screen? Please let me know.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, thank you. So there is a barrier at x equal to 0 position and the particles encounter the barrier and then we see what happens. Now, if the particles have energy E, which is greater than the barrier, which is case one for us, then what happens is that the particles move here, come up to this point. Some of them are reflected and then some of them get transmitted. Okay, and we solve for this case. We solve what is the reflection coefficient, we solve what is the transmission coefficient, and we did that by first solving the Schrodinger equation. So this was the Schrodinger equation in the two regions, x less than 0 region and x greater than equal to 0 region. And after solving these Schrodinger equations, we got these solutions. And once we got these solutions, we had to find out what the A, B, C and D are. D, of course, here is 0 for psi 2 of x in the second region because there is no reflection that is happening. So this part is essentially non-existent. So the coefficient D is 0. All right. So there is so then the psi 1 and psi 2 of x become these two solutions. And now we need to find A, B, and C. So what we did was we applied boundary conditions and then we found out A, B, and C. Once we had A, B, and C, then we found out the reflection and transmission coefficient by first getting the current density, right? So reflection coefficient is current density for the reflected wave divided by the current density of the incident wave, right? And the whole modulus. And transmission coefficient is the current density of the transmitted wave divided by the current density of the incident wave, right? The magnitude of the current densities. So this is our transmission coefficient and then we obtained it. Now, another important point here was that what was the probability in the two regions, right? Probability of observing or probability that a particle is at a position x in region 1 and region 2. So in region 1, the probability turned out to be a cause function. And in region 2, the probability turned out to be a constant. So obviously, but at the point x equal to 0, the probabilities have to be equal. So it is a continuous function. So in region 1, it is a cause function and in region 2, it is a constant. So this is the probability distribution curve with respect to x. All right. So these were the main points in the case where energy was greater than V naught. All right. Now we are going to go to the second case. Okay, I hope all this is clear. So now we will move on to the second case. Alright, so now let's move on to the case where energy is less than V naught. Any question from the first part? Okay, please let me know if you have any questions. Alright. Alright, so now we move on to the second case where energy of the particle is less than V naught. Again, the particles are moving in from the left and then they encounter a potential and then we have to see what happens. Now, the energy of the particle is less than V naught. So classically, what will happen is if the energy of a particle is less than the potential barrier, then classically what will happen is that because the a particle will hit the barrier, it will be reflected back. There will be no transmission across the barrier, right? That is what will happen classically. So classically, if particles are arriving at the potential step from left with momentum, So energy is E, so obviously momenta is going to be root of 2ma, right? The particles will come to a stop at x equal to 0, and then they all of the particles will be reflected back with the same magnitude of momentum, right? So the magnitude remains same, of course the direction changes. All right. This is what happens classically, if it is a classical particle, right? And this is what is going to happen. But what happens if it is a quantum particle, which is what we are dealing with here? So if it is a quantum particle, the picture is going to be different. And to see what that picture is going to be, we need to solve the Schrödinger equation. So the Schrödinger equation needs to be solved for the two regions, right? X less than 0 region and X greater than 0 region. Okay, so we need to solve the Schrödinger equation in the two regions and then see what happens. So in region 1, right, in region 1 where x is less than 0, it is this exactly same similar situation as in case 1, right? It is exactly the same setup. Okay, just that energy magnitude is low, energy is lower. But other than that, everything is the same. The in x less than 0 region, there is no potential that the particle is encountering. So everything is the same as in case 1. So the Schrödinger equation is also the same, right? Which is d square by dx square plus k1 square whole into psi 1 of x is equal to 0. So this is the Schrödinger equation. And the solution for this equation is that a into e power I k1x plus b into e power minus I k1x. Right, so everything is the same in region 1, no change. Now what happens in region 2? Okay, now in region 2 we have energy is less than V0. So generally how we do it for region 2 is the energy becomes E minus V0, right? That is your energy. So the Schrödinger equation is basically minus h cross square by 2n, d square by dx square into psi 2 of x. Any questions? Okay. So d square by dx square into psi 2 of x is equal to, now the energy is E minus V naught into psi 2 of x. So this term is negative, right? E minus V naught is negative because E is less than V naught. Okay. So all now I'm doing is I'm taking this minus h cross square by 2m to the other side. So if I take it to the other side, you will have minus 2m by h cross square into E minus V naught into psi 2 of x. Okay, now what I'll do is I'll take this entire term to the left hand side. So I'm going to get this equation. Okay, d square by dx square plus 2m by h cross square into E minus V naught psi 2 of x. So again, E minus V naught is negative. So this term is actually negative. So like usually what we do is all this is a constant, right? E, V naught to m, h cross, everything is a constant. So this constant, we take it as k2 square. Right, that's what we did even the last time. So when we take it as k2 square and this term, entire term is negative, it will mean that k2 will become a imaginary term, right? Because this k2 square is negative, so k2, when you take the root square root of a negative term, it will k2 will become imaginary, right? So k2 is imaginary, it is not something very convenient. Okay, so what we'll do is we'll have a minus here and then make this term positive. Okay, so that's what we have done here. All right, so we'll have minus 2m by h cross square into V naught minus E, right? So this term becomes positive and the minus goes outside. Okay, is this clear? So just a simple algebra here. I've not done anything here. Okay, any new concept is not introduced here. It's just simple algebra. All right. So now this term, this constant, I'm calling it k2 dash square. Okay. So k2 dash square is 2m by h cross square into v naught minus e. So this term is positive. So obviously k2 dash is going to become real. All right. So now this is in the same format as the previous case, right? In the previous case also, if you see this k1 square is nothing but 2me by h cross square. That is a positive term. So here also we wanted to write k2 dash square in terms of a positive term. Okay, so that's what we have done. So our equation becomes d square by dx square minus k2 dash square whole thing multiplied with psi 2 of x equal to 0. So this is the Schrodinger equation for the second region, which is x greater than equal to 0. Now we need to solve this equation. So this is a simple differential equation, right? So obviously the solution is going to be, so the two roots of this e, of this second order differential equation are k plus k2 and minus k2. So these are the two roots. So we are going to have psi 2 of x is equal to c into e power minus k2 dash x plus d into e power plus k2 dash x. Okay. All right. So this is our solution. Now, one of the things that you can notice here is, of course, here in this case, there is no I. That is one of the things that you notice. If you compare it with the second region of the first case, okay, let's do that. Okay. Let's do that. Let's compare it with the second region of the first case. Right? The second region for case one was c into e power I k2x plus d into e power minus I k2x. So there is a difference. Here it is c into e power minus k2 dash x plus d into e power plus k2 dash x. There is no I basically. That is the difference here. Right? So there is no I. And now we have to see, right? Now we have to, first of all, we have to find out what are these a, b, c, and d, right? So we have psi 1 of x, it has two constants a and b, and psi 2 of x has two constants c and d. Now, one of the things that you can notice here is, because this is e power plus k2x plus k2 dash x, so what happens if this is the region where x is greater than 0. So x can go up to infinity. So if x goes up to infinity, this term will become infinity, right? And the problem is that a wave function should not be diverging, okay? It has to be some finite quantity or something, or it can decay, but it should not, or it can decay, it can oscillate, but it cannot be diverging. But if we keep this term, then when x goes to infinity, this whole term goes to infinity, okay? So this is something that is unphysical for a wave function. So then basically the solution is, of course, that the constant b is equal to 0. So there is, this term is basically not there, okay? So since the wave function has to be finite everywhere, and since it diverges when x tends to infinity, because then b into e power k2 dash x will also go to infinity. Therefore, d is equal to 0. And so psi 2 of x is nothing but only this term. Okay, so psi 2 of x is c into e power minus k2 dash x. Is this clear? Okay. All right. So what we have done so far, we have solved the Schrodinger equation for the secondary, for the first region and the second region. First region stays the same as the previous case where E was greater than V naught. And second region, there is slight difference. So in the second region now, we have, first of all, the differences in terms of K2 becoming K2 dash, and there is no I here. And second thing is that the D coefficient D will go to 0. So psi 2 of x is only this term. Alright, so the complete wave function with respect to time as well is going to be this, right? Psi 1 of x into e power minus I omega t for x less than 0, and psi 2 of x into e power minus I omega t for x greater than equal to 0. Okay, so I have just expanded the psi 1 of x and psi 2 of x. Okay, so there is a typo here. I hope you guys have noticed. So e power minus I omega t should have been written here as well, which I have missed. Okay, so please correct it in when you're reading it. Okay, don't assume that this is correct. Obviously, there is some discrepancy here. Here I've written e power minus I omega t, here it is missing. So it should be there. This is just a typo. Alright. Okay. So this is the complete wave function. So now what we need to do is we need to find A, B, and C. Right, we need to find these A, B, and C. So how will we find A, B, and C? Okay, can someone please tell me how we'll find the coefficients? Yeah.
boundary condition then?
Yes, boundary condition. So again, what will the boundary conditions be?
If x is equal to 0, both function will be equal.
Yes.
And
And second boundary condition. Yeah.
the derivative of both the function will also be equal at x is equal to 0.
Yes, exactly. So those are the boundary conditions. Okay. So I hope you guys now know, right, how to solve it. Like you guys have already done it in the previous class. So I'm doing the same thing. So at x equal to 0, psi 1 of x is equal to psi 2 of x. And the second boundary condition is d psi 1 by dx is equal to d psi 2 by dx at x equal to 0. So from the first condition, I'm getting a plus b is equal to c. And from the second condition, I have to first take the derivative. So I'm taking the derivative, then setting x equal to 0, and then I'm getting I k1 into a minus b is equal to minus k2 dash into c. Okay, so now using these two equations, a plus b equal to c and this equation, right? Or I've just converted, rewritten this equation in this form. So from these two equations, you can get a and b, right? Or b and c in terms of a. Right, so this is what I've done. So c is equal to 2k1 by k1 plus i k2 dash into a, and then b turns out to be k1 minus i k2 dash by k1 plus i k2 dash into a. Okay, so these are your coefficients in the wave function. All right, so once we have got the coefficient, now second thing that we need to do is we need to find what is the current density for incident, transmitted and reflected wave. Right? So let's do that. So in order to find the current densities, we need to define what the incident wave is, reflected wave is and the transmitted wave is. So incident wave is obviously a into e power plus I k1x. Reflected wave is b into e power minus i k1x, and transmitted wave is c into e power minus k2 dash x. Okay. Now, one of the things that you can immediately do is you can find what is the current density for transmission. Okay. So if you find out current density for transmission, you have to use this formula, right? Which is I h cross by 2m into, now you have to use the wave function for transmission, right? Transmitted wave. So you have psi tx, psi t into d psi star by dx, right? Minus psi t star into d psi t by dx, right? So this is your current density. Now, one of the things that you can notice here is this is your psi t of x. So what is psi t star of x, right? What is the conjugate, complex conjugate of psi t?
Same function.
Same function, exactly. So it is the same function. So if so basically this term will become equal to this term because psi t star is not any different from psi t of x, right? So essentially this term and this term are equal. Okay, you can also do the derivations and like differentiation and find out. But because psi t and psi t star are exactly the same, these two will be this term will be equal to this term, and so this j t will become zero. Okay, so that's what we have. Okay, so JT, current density for transmission will become zero, which means T, transmission coefficient, is what? Magnitude of JT by JI, right? And since JT is zero, so this transmission coefficient becomes zero. Now, we also know that the relation reflection coefficient plus transmission coefficient has to be equal 1, right? This we already know. So obviously, if t is 0, then r is going to be 1. So without calculation itself, we know that r is going to be 1. But you can also verify, like you can do the entire calculation and also see what you get for r. Okay? So if you do this calculation, you will get this term and this will be equal to 1. Okay? So you can do this calculation and verify it for yourself. But even without doing the calculation, because t you got to be 0, so r is obviously going to be 1. So, but this represents the classical situation, right? So, in the classical situation, what did I say? I said that since the particle has energy less than the potential barrier, they will hit the barrier and then be reflected. All the particles will be reflected back, okay? they are not going to be transmitted, right? This was the diagram here, right? The particles will hit the barrier and then they will be reflected back. So they are not going to be transmitted. This is the classical situation, and we are getting back something that is classical, right? But there is still some difference, okay? I told you that in quantum mechanics, the picture is slightly different. So here also, though, we are getting the classical picture. So then what is the difference here? Okay, so we do have some difference, and that difference can be seen when you compute the probabilities. Okay, so as soon as you compute probabilities, you will be able to see what the difference is. So again, because there are two regions and we computed the wave functions in the two regions, we will compute the probabilities also in the two regions. Okay, so for region one, the wave function was psi 1 of x, so p 1 of x, right? The probability in region one is basically psi 1 star into psi 1, right? And this is the same as case one. There is no difference here because the entire function is same as the region one in case one, right? Case one was e greater than v naught. So again, we are getting some constant plus some cos function, right? There is no difference. So again, there is some cos. So this probability is essentially some cos function, right? Now, what is the second probability? Probability in region 2. Region 2 is psi 2 star of x into psi 2. Now, psi 2 star is same as psi 2, right? Because there is no I in the wave function for psi 2. So again, it's going to be c square into e power minus 2 k2 dash x, right? So this is the difference between case 1 and case 2. In case 1, what happened? You got the probability in the second region to be constant. But in case 2, what is happening? The probability in the second region is some exponentially decaying function of x. Right? It is e power minus 2, e power minus some constant into x. Right? That is your function. All right. So this is an exponentially decaying. Of course, if you now put what is the value of c square, you can write it in this fashion. All right. So this one you can verify later, but it's just a simple algebraic computation. All right. So the main point here is that in the second region, the probability is an exponentially decaying function of x. So which means that physically, what does this represent? Right. Physically, this means that even though there is a potential barrier, and even though the energy of the particle is less than the potential of the barrier, still some particles are able to cross the barrier, right? So basically what this means is there is still some small problem. Okay, this is an exponentially decaying function. Okay, exponential decaying functions decay very fast. Okay, with x, you know, greater than 1, it will just keep on decaying very fast, right? This term, if you put some value of x here, it will be a very small number, all right? So the probability for the particle to be on the other side of the barrier, which is region 2, is very small, but still it is a non-zero probability, okay? Which means there might be some probability that the particle has moved to the other side. Okay, so this is a picture that is different from classical mechanics. In classical mechanics, if energy is less than V0, then none of the particles will be moving across the barrier. But now in quantum mechanical picture, some particles are moving across the barrier. Okay, obviously for that, the barrier has to be very thin. All right, but still some particles are able to move across the other side. Okay, there is a finite probability for particles to move on the other side. So now if you draw the picture, right, if you make the plot of P of X versus X, okay, so if you make the plot of P of X versus X for this second case, so in region 1, it is a cos function, and in region 2, it is a exponentially decaying function. Okay, so this is the plot for P of X versus X. Remember, these plots are very important, okay, because it tells you what is the probability of finding the particle in each region, right? And in quantum mechanics, we cannot know what the exact position of the particle is, but we can know what is the probability of finding the particle, and therefore these plots are very important. Is this clear? I'll give you a minute to take it in, but please let me know if you have any questions. Okay, so this thing is a bit counterintuitive. Okay, how if there is a barrier, but still something is moving across the barrier, right? So it is a bit counterintuitive, but this is what happens in quantum mechanics, and this theory has been verified many number of times in through experiments. Okay, so the experiments are obviously done using a quantum particle. So quantum particles such as a photon, electron, and stuff like that. And then you keep a barrier. The barriers are generally like some semiconductor material and some very thin barrier. And you will see that electrons are passing across the that barrier. Okay, so this is used. So this phenomenon. Okay, this phenomenon where some quantum mechanical particle is moving in a region which is classically forbidden. Okay, this region. Region 2 is classically forbidden for any particle, right? Because according to classical mechanics, no particle should have been able to cross the barrier. But still, you find some particle here, some quantum particle here. So this phenomenon where a quantum particle is found in a region which is classically forbidden is known as quantum tunneling. Okay? So in this case, region 2 of this case, where in this case, the region 2 part, right, where E is less than V naught, but in region 2 classically the particle should not have been there, but still quantum mechanically they are present. There is a probability of the particle being present there. So this phenomenon is known as quantum tunneling. Okay, is that clear? So this phenomenon of quantum tunneling is used in semiconductor industries where you want to increase the current efficiency or something like that, right? So this phenomenon is used a lot over there. Okay, any questions up to this point? All right. So now I'm going to show you a small YouTube video. So there is a nice YouTube video I found about quantum tunneling and how you can look at it, you know, how you can look at it in a simple, like in day-to-day life. Okay, so should I share the YouTube video just through Google Meet, or should I, or will you watch it on your own? So Akash has asked a question. If the transmission coefficient is zero, then why we are getting probability on the other side? Okay, so one of the things that you can notice is, right, that the probability here is not some very high probability. It is a exponentially decaying function, right? Which means that if x is very close to zero, only then you have some probability. Otherwise, as you move further and further away in this side, your this function is going to be very close to zero. Okay, it is almost going to be zero. Some it might be 10 power minus 20 or whatever, right? So the point is that transmission coefficient is some magnitude, which in this case, it shows what is the classical thing that you will expect. So here in this case, it is showing what it is, what you will expect in the classical case. But actual thing that you can see is only given by the probability. That's why it's important to compute probability. So if you do not compute probabilities, you do not know what exactly is happening. Because just by calculating the transmission coefficient, it may not give us the correct picture. Okay. Although in case one, it did give us the correct picture, right? There was some transmission and some reflection, but somehow in case two, it is not giving us the correct picture. So the correct picture, if you want to obtain, you have to compute the probabilities. Okay. So there is a discrepancy between what is the transmission and what is the probability. Okay. All right. Okay, so any questions? Did you follow the video? Right? Okay, I'll share the link of the video. You can watch it again. But this was a nice simple example of how you can see quantum tunneling, right? So he did it with respect to photons, and the photons were passing through the barrier, and then the camera was capturing whatever the photon was displaying. All right. So any questions, any thoughts? All right. So this is an important concept of quantum tunneling, okay? And that's why in quantum mechanics, the picture is much different from what happens in the classical situation. So this was one of the problems that we solved. So now there is another problem, right, which we will solve, but I'll just give you the basics and I'm going to leave it to you to do this as a homework. Okay, the solution of this, this entire problem is solved in the book, but now that you have understood all the different cases and how to, you know, write down the Schrodinger equation, how to get the solutions, you can also do it yourself and then verify with the book, right? So this is going to be your homework problem. So here what we will do, okay? By the way, let me know if you have any questions, okay? All right. So in this problem, what we will do is there is a potential V naught from going from 0 to a certain distance A on the positive x-axis. All right. And basically, the problem is such that you consider a beam of particles of mass m that are sent from left on a potential. So it is going, so the particles are moving from the left direction and then they are hitting the potential barrier. The potential is so the potential has energy V naught, right? And it lasts from 0 to A, okay? And the particle has energy E. Now again, there can be two cases whether the particle energy E is either greater than V naught or less than V naught. So these are the two cases, all right? So case one is E great, sorry, this should not be zero. Okay, please correct this typo. So case one is E is greater than V naught and case two is E is less than V naught, all right? So again, the potential is repulsive because it is going upward. So that when the particle is moving in this region between zero and A, then the particle is experiencing a repulsive potential, meaning the energy of the particle reduces, right? The energy, if E is greater than V naught, the energy of the particle in this region becomes E minus V naught, right? So this is a repulsive potential. All right. So case one is E is greater than V naught. All right. So again, this is going to be for region one. It is going to be when you solve for the Schrodinger equation, right? It is going to be a similar solution. We get A into e power I k1x plus B into e power minus I k1x. Now in this region, region two, again, E is greater than V naught. So you'll get C into e power I k2x plus D into e power minus I k2x, okay? So in region one, this is the Schrodinger equation you solve and you get this wave function. In region two, this is the Schrodinger equation you solve where k2 square is 2m into e power e minus v naught by h cross square. So the wave function psi 2 of x is this term. Now notice here that we are not making d to be zero. Why? Because there is again this barrier. So it is anyway going to be reflected. This is not going to infinity, the barrier, right? So there is, the barrier is ending in this at the position x equal to a. So there is a chance for the particles to be reflected. And that is why the d coefficient is not set to zero. Okay, so this is the solution for the wave function in the second region. In the third region, you have again this Schrodinger equation. So the wave function is going to be g into e power I k1x plus h into e power minus I k1x. Now you set h to be zero. The constant h has to be set to zero because here there is no reflection that can happen, right? So h part is going to be zero, right? So this part is going to be zero. So your wave function is only g into e power I k1x. Okay, so now you have to find the relation between A, B, C, D, G and all of that and find the reflection and transmission coefficient and also find the probabilities in these regions. So I have a question. So what is the boundary condition here? What are the boundary conditions for this problem? Can someone tell me?
Both boundaries, the wave function should be equal.
Right. And also?
And the derivatives should be equal.
Yeah. So at both boundaries, so at both at x equal to 0 and at x equal to a. Okay, so those are the boundaries. So using those boundary conditions, you can solve for the coefficients and then you can get the current density, and then you can solve for reflection and transmission coefficient. Okay, and then you can also solve for the probabilities, right? What are the probabilities in the three regions, right? So if you solve for probabilities in the three regions, you will get something like this. In the first region also it is a cost function. In the second region also it is a cost function, but the intensity and the frequency of the wave function has reduced, right? Because the energy is reduced here, right? It is E minus V naught. The particle is moving with energy E minus V naught. So the energy is reduced, and therefore the intensity and magnitude of the wave function also reduces. And so you are going to get, so the height of this wave function is going to be smaller, and also the wave function is going to be not as much oscillating as in the other case. Okay, and then in the third region it is a constant. Okay, so once you solve for probabilities, you will get this kind of a picture for probability versus x. Okay, so all of this is your homework. Okay, I want you to solve for all of this. All right, and then case two, where E is less than V naught, first region remains the same, right? Again, it is, you are solving this Schrodinger equation, you're getting this wave function. Second region, in the second region, again, that issue is there, that issue where this term has to be kept positive. So this, there is a minus sign over here. And because of this, the wave function does not have the I term. So it has only C into e power k2 dash x plus D into e power minus k2 dash x. So this you can, this is for region 2. And then for region 3, again, you have this wave function, which is similar to the region 1, right? Because again, the particle is moving with energy. But again, here, there is no reflection because there is no further boundary here. So no reflection. And so the H term is going to be 0. Right, and so the wave function in region 3 is g into e power I k1 x. Okay, all right. So now again, using the boundary conditions, you can find the constants, you can compute the r and t, reflection and transmission coefficient, and you can find the probabilities in the three regions. Okay, so can you tell me what happens in region, what is the probability, what will the probability look like in region 1?
Cost function.
Yeah, cost function in region 1. And in region 2, it will be?
Decay and increase.
Yeah. Yeah, so it will be like a decay. Right. Okay. And then in the third part, it will be a constant. Okay. So here it will be a constant. So this is going to be your wave function. Your probability. So you can solve for this, and then this is your homework. Okay, so for this lecture, this is going to be your homework. Please do this entire problem properly, right? Write down full all the equations, write down the, do like plot the diagrams, write down the equations, solve for the constants, everything, right? So this is going to be your homework here. Okay, any questions up to this point? All right, then I will stop here and we can meet tomorrow again. Okay,
ma'am,
and
hello.
Yeah.
So the boundary conditions are already, I mean, given to a particular wave function. So suppose there is a new type of, suppose we are studying a new type of particle, and we get some kind of graph like this. And so we can put a boundary condition, or the boundary condition are likely to be like already been given there, and we just to check.
Boundary condition is something that is that comes from the system that you are studying. Okay, so here in this case, the system is that, yeah,
so most probably all the cases have the same kind of boundary condition. I mean,
yes,
most of the, I mean, most of the
yes.
time you can see that
most of the
equal.
Time it will be similar. Yes, exactly. So you have to look at the problem and then decide, okay, what are the boundary conditions where and all the potential is or the energy is changing. And because there are three regions, so in each, at the boundary of each, boundary of two regions, you will have some boundary condition, right? So between this region and this region, you have one boundary condition. Between this region and this region, you have another boundary condition, right?
So, ma'am, can you break in other regions too? I mean, can you make it much more, like maybe you can have five or six boundary conditions.
Yeah. So this problem, right, which I've told you, this can be extended now, isn't it? So earlier we solved for a problem where this was zero, potential was zero, and then it became V naught and it stayed V naught. Now we are solving a variant where it is zero, then it goes to V naught, then it comes back to zero again. Okay. Similarly, you can have a problem where it goes to, it is zero, then V naught, then again back to zero, then again it will go to V naught at some B, x equal to B, it goes to V naught. Right? This kind of variations of the problem you can imagine. So depending on what the problem is, that many boundary conditions you are going to have, right?
Oh, okay. I got it. Thank you.
Yeah. Anything else?
Hello.
Yes. Yes, Paras, your voice is very low.
Okay. Can you hear me now?
Okay. We can try. Yeah. Tell me.
And so, what happens at the boundary? What happens at the boundary to the wave function, particularly when E is equal to V naught?
E is equal to V naught. That we have seen, no? When E is equal to let's see. I think we looked at this case earlier, right? So let's see here. Right, at E equal to V naught, you can find out, right? K2 will become zero, isn't it? Because K2 is defined, is proportion, K2 square is proportional to E minus V naught, right? So at E equal to V naught, K2 will become zero, and so you will not have that particular term. And so it depends on what the transmission or reflection coefficient will be, right? So you can find what K2 is, and that way you can solve the problem.
Whether wave function be like, it has to transition, it has to be transitioned from the region 1 to region 2, which is classically prohibited, right?
Yes.
So for E, so like, what will be the form of the wave function when E is equal to V? I didn't get that part.
So I think when E is equal to V naught, the form of the wave function at x equal to 0 will still be this just k1 part, okay, and then it will become 0 beyond that. Okay, so this is the case where E is right. I think at E equal to 0 is not very clear. I mean, if you go from E was greater than V naught and up to the point where E equal to V naught, then transmission will become zero and reflection will become one, which is what is happening because K2 will become zero, right? So if K2 is zero, then T will become zero and only you'll have reflection is what will happen. Okay. Think about it. Maybe we can discuss again in the next class. But this is what I feel will happen. But when E is less than V naught, still it is going to transmit. So, okay, no. But there should be still some probability that the particle has moved to the other side, okay? So even though transmission coefficient becomes zero, the probability should not be zero. Okay, so there should still be some probability that it goes to the other side. So that is something that one has to see how it can be brought about. Okay. Yeah, because let's look at this other situation. So in this other situation, So in this other situation where E is less than V naught, okay, what is the probability that we get? Probability that we get is C into E power minus K2X. Okay, so if K2 is 0, right, then this term will become 1 and you will still have some probability remaining. Okay, so it will be a constant probability is what will happen. Okay, so the so particle is going to go to the other side, but it is just going to be a constant. So in both the cases, it will be a constant. Both in case one and case two, it will be a constant. Is that clear? I think this from the probabilities you have to see, because if you see from transmission and reflection, classically and quantum mechanically they will be different or they might not be different. It depends. But probabilities give you the correct picture. I think that's the right thing to look at.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. All right. So I'll stop here and I'll share the notes with you. I'll also share the link of the YouTube video that we have just watched and you can go through it again. All right. Bye-bye. See you tomorrow.